welcome to the Abu Dhabi Book Fair, Manoj Das, one of the most respected names in contemporary Indian literature. He's written short stories and novels extensively for children and adults in both English and in his native language, Odia. His writings on Indian philosophy, mysticism, and spiritualism have been widely published in India and abroad during the last six decades of his distinguished writing career. Our session today will be a discussion between the author and Mr. S. Gopalakrishnan, the UAE-based Malayalam writer and journalist. They'll be talking about Indian values in a changing world. The title of the discussion, My Little India, is taken from Manoj Das' book of travelogues of the same name, which is published by the National Book Trust. Please give a very warm welcome to our esteemed guests.
The very outset, I'm thankful to the Abu Dhabi Book Fair, the organizers, especially the National Book Trust of India, for giving me an opportunity to meet a great author whom I wanted to meet for so long. And welcome, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
We have taken today's the title for today's debate as My Little India, based on a book authored by him. Before getting into the details of the book, let me start my question with, in an interview given for an Indian newspaper, once you said, when an Indian writer is naturally Indian, his Indianness is hardly pronounced, but what becomes grotesquely pronounced is when an Indian writer makes a conscious effort to highlight his Indianness, does the opposite, tries to consciously cultivate a stance that should appear different from a traditional writing. This is what you said to Times of India.
What did I say exactly?
The Indian, when, if you are an Indian writer, if you are asked to prove that you're an Indian writer, you are getting into a problem. The Indianness, if you have to establish, you have to prove that you are an Indian writer, there is an issue.
Oh, I see, yeah. Very, very profound question, actually. I believe there are certain things which should be obvious by the very truth of their presence. And Indianness is a reality which cannot be done away with even if I wish to. I mean, this unexpected question reminds me of I will not forget the incident. Some 15 years ago, Association of Cultural Relationship, there was a brainwave for the authorities to hold a conference of Indian writers living abroad, like V.S. Naipaul, etc., and some of the about 15 Indian writers whom they considered to be worth inviting, whatever it is. So about 30 of us were brought to Nimrana Palace Heritage Hotel in Rajasthan. And first day was an indoor discussion. The subject was, does the Indian writer have an identity of his own? Very near to your question, sir. Now, Farooq Dhonde, one of our writers living in America, he was presiding, and one young lady writer from Canada, Indian, I mean, she very clumsily, she said, my identity is written on my suitcase. And Ved Mehta, you must have heard of him, a phenomenon by himself, is a blind but a very gifted writer living in the United States of America. And he was on the staff of New Yorker magazine, the prestigious magazine also. And so Ved Mehta said that, well, I'm an exiled Indian. I'm living outside India, exiled Indian writer, that's all. The moment he said this, our indomitable Khushwant Singh, you must have all heard his name, Mr. Khushwant Singh, who was a very, very significant writer in India and editor of Illustrated Weekly of India, the most popular weekly magazine. And my relationship with him was, I was a frequent contributor to that famous magazine. Now, suddenly Khushwant Singh burst out. You, Ved Mehta, you have self-exiled yourself. Out of your own sweet will, you are living outside India, like many, many Indians living abroad. But we Sikhs are exiled in our own country. He was referring to the anti-Sikh riot.
Yes.
And he became very, very agitated. And there was a uneasy silence in the audience. Nobody knew what to do after that, because about 50 writers were there all together. It was not open to public that day. Next day it was open to public. And so it was an embarrassing moment. Farooq Dhondle, president, I looked at him, he looked at me. So I thought that he would like me to speak something. And then I looked at Khushwant Singh and said, Mr. Khushwant Singh, when I read your first short story when I was a high school student, and I did not know that you were Sikh or anything, because Singh is a surname that is available in many parts of India. Until I saw your photograph much later, in those days photographs are not very easily available. I'm speaking of 1940s, my high school days. I did not know that you are a Sardarji, you are a Sikh and all that. But I know that whatever you are loved all over India. Whatever you write, that may be, there is a different question. But don't you think that Khushwant Singh, the writer, is greater than Khushwant Singh of a particular few months in the checkered history of India? India is a large country, it is a long history, and many unfortunate episodes have taken place. I hang my head in shame when I think of the anti-Sikh riots, but then you definitely do not deem yourself to be confined to that. Your identities were greater than that. Then he asked, what do you mean by the Indian identity? I said, Indian identity has to be felt, not to be uttered necessarily. Then I referred to a particular incident. There was a great professor of evolution from outside India. He was a thorough scholar on the theories of evolution. Once he visited India, he had a friend, the vice chancellor of an Indian university. They were friends in Cambridge or Oxford somewhere. But he came not to lecture, he came to rest in India for some time. But at the request of his friend, the vice chancellor, he agreed to speak deliver a short speech for the research scholars and members of staff of his university. And he said, he gave a summary of the history of evolution from pre-Darwinian times to Louis Leakey Jr., etc., and ultimately he said, my knowledge of evolution underwent a revolutionary change by reading an Indian who is not a scientist. And the audience was a little amused. Who is he? He is neither a scientist nor a known academic scholar. He is a sage, a savant. His name is Sri Aurobindo. He says that whatever evolves, it is involved. A flower evolves because it was involved in the bud. Bud had evolved because it was involved in the stem. Stem was involved in the plant. Plant was involved in the seed. So evolution is necessarily preceded by involution. And if out of matter life had emerged, out of life mind had emerged, something greater than mind could emerge out of the present human beings, mental human beings, and that will justify the future evolution of man. And when he finished the lecture, clouds had gathered and it started raining. So, am I clear? Everybody can hear? And then the speaker told the audience, don't stand on formalities, please disperse immediately, rains are coming. And everybody dispersed. The Vice Chancellor brought his car to the portico, and he was going to board the car, but splashes of rain were coming. Somebody held an umbrella on his head. And the scholar looked at the person. He was an elderly man in a dhoti and a torn shirt and a dilapidated umbrella he was holding. And the scholar thanked him, thank you. But this man said, sir, I should thank you. What a brilliant speech you made. And the scholar was surprised. You could follow my speech? He said, yes, sir. I'm an old matriculate. I was the headmaster of a primary school. My son is a clerk here. He's in charge of the auditorium. After my retirement, I come. Sometimes I stay with him. And I heard your lecture. I understood it. But some members of the audience, they were murmuring, saying that looking at the present consciousness of human beings, it is difficult to believe man will evolve into something better or nobler. But why should they have that doubt? He's himself stating this. So the scholar asked him, what do you mean? He said, sir, what I mean is this. Now it is raining, you cannot see. There is my son's small quarters. In front of that quarters, there's a lake. Sometimes in the morning when I come out of his house, I see a lotus has bloomed on that lake. When I look at the lotus and I see that out of a thing like filth and mud, with the blessings of the sun, a wonder like lotus has been possible. Why not out of the present fill the mind of human beings, violent mind of human beings, with the grace of the divine, something wonderful cannot come? Who says it cannot come? This was, I said, this is Indian identity. This man is basically an Indian who has incorrigible faith in man, because man is created by some unseen power, a profound power. It could not be just a futile production, a futile creation. There must be some purpose behind it, a future for it. So that is my view of the Indian identity.
Thank you. Manoj Das is a great conversationist, and I never expected that, you know, he would take a simple question from my side about what is Indianness or another. He took us to the theory of spiritual evolution of Maharishi Aurobindo, and all it was going to that plane. Thank you, sir. Now, before getting into your book, my one more question. Again, it is to you. For you, India is not a land. It is an idea. I read what you wrote sometimes. There is an invisible, sublime India. There is another India, which is a geographical India in the mythologies and in history. And another is India in literature. And the other one is the modern India, which we all are aware of. Before getting into the other question, certainly we will come back to your journey to Aurobindo and all later. But my next question is, as a writer, what is India in literature?
What is?
India in literature, our literature. Literature.
Which?
India in literature. What is India in Indian literature?
Oh, India in Indian literature is as vast as India itself.
I have a problem. I think that is the feedback is not there. he's unable to. He's unable to listen, I think.
No. So because of that, some resounding. No, I can. Once you clear, make it clear. It is very clear. You see, India is in Indian literature is not a uniform portrayal. First of all, as he himself had quoted me, that there was a geographical India. But geographical India has not remained the same. In the epic times, for example, Madhya Deso. Where is Madhya Deso today? Modern Afghanistan is Madhya Deso. Now, Gandhar, Kandahar is Gandhar. Now, geography has changed. Unfortunately, in our time, if not 21st century, 20th century, India became divided into three nations, Pakistan and Bangladesh, apart from the original India. But I am convinced of the fact that there is a subtle India, a Sukhma Bharatvarsha, a subtle India, which presides over the consciousness of the rural multitudes, millions of people who have been brought up. There, you see, one great man, C.P. Ramaswamy Iyer, once said that Indian literacy is not by eyes but by ear. Because the rural folks, they were educated by listening to the epics, listening to the mythological works, listening to the great folklore, of which India should be proud, world's first collection of fables, Panchatantra, the first collection of fiction, Brihat Katha, Katha Charita Sagara, first collection of didactic stories like Jatakas, etc., etc. So, Indians, even though were illiterate in the sense, modern sense, could not read and write, they were not really murkha, I mean illiterate in that ordinary sense of the term. So, their India, even today, despite, because I am constantly in touch with, born and brought up in a remote village, luckily I am still in touch with the rural folks, and I can assure you that that India lives in their consciousness even today. There are strange phenomena, how much influence these epics had on the unknown areas of Indian life. I will give you one instance, sir. In my home state, Odisha, the tribal area divided into few districts and prominently Koraput district. There is a range of hills, the home of a particular tribe. And can you believe, I visited that hamlet first and last time in 1960s. Things might have changed meanwhile. The women folk of the tribe go bare. They do not clothe themselves. Below their tummy, some intricate ornaments are there covering the lower part of their body. But they don't use, men folk use clothes, but they don't use clothes. Why? The legend goes back to thousands of years. You know some of you know the story of Ramayana, outline of Ramayana. Sita is a wonderful character. And for some time in her life, along with her husband Ramo and brother-in-law Lakshmana, she was obliged to live in Dandakaranya, the primeval forest of India. There is a sweet river, Tamosa. One day she was bathing in that river without any clothes. And some tribal women were passing by, looking down into the river, they laughed. And Sita told them, being yourselves children of nature, how don't you see that at this moment of my life, I'm one with nature, I have no inhibition of any kind, I'm alone with nature today, how could you laugh? These women folk became so repentant. They refused to wear clothes themselves thereafter, and thousands of years have passed. Imagine, I have asked any number of historians, anthropologists, research scholars, what is the origin of this tradition? Nobody has been able to give a satisfactory reply. When three interpreters have asked their own people, they say, well, our grandfather, their grandfather, it has been dying, it is going on like this. And we have no sense of guilt. We don't want people to come and see us. We are quite happy with our life. Of course, things must have changed by this time. So the impact of this mythology in India is something which is phenomenal. I don't think, you see, in the ancient world, we had four great epics, Homer's Iliad and Odyssey, Ramayana and Mahabharata in India. Iliad and Odyssey, today they are limited to vocabulary through phrases. Hundreds of phrases we use from Homer's Iliad and Odyssey, that's all. But in everyday life of the rural folks, the institutions, the traditions initiated by Ramayana and Mahabharata still go strong. I do not know what will happen 50 years hence, but today, even today, it's the reality. Thank you.
I think this Dandakaranya story which you are mentioning is the inquest of the mythical forest which you have mentioned in the...
Yes.
Widely discussed this, about this Dandakaranya forest, is widely discussed in this particular book. Now, before coming here, we were discussing about your childhood memories and all, especially the Chasing the Rainbow, the book which you have written on your childhood. And after that, you were saying about in your teens and in your young days, your journeys with the left movement in Orissa. And after that, you it changed your patterns of thinking and you got into the spiritual way of thinking. And but when now you say that, you know, just now you said that, you know, Iliad is not a living tradition, but the epics of India is a living tradition. I have a question for you. The distorted rides on Hinduism at the moment, I'm getting into the political context in India. When you say that, you know, the mythologies, the epics, all are living traditions in India, and you say about the spiritual evolution, and you say about Indian mythology, Indian thought process, and all. But at the in the present Indian political context, whether this word Hinduism and Indianness is widely and dangerously distorted.
I fully agree with you. It is dangerously distorted indeed, that is the word. You see, Hinduism is not caste system. Hindu is not communalism. Hinduism originally does not mean hundreds of symptoms by which we recognize Hinduism today, or those who are pioneers, self-proclaimed pioneers of Hinduism, they say. Hinduism is a quest for truth. It is an aspiration to come out of the vast ocean of ignorance in which we remain submerged. The essential aim of Hinduism is very clearly described in one of our great ancient works, Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. Asadoma Sadgamaya, Tamasoma Jyotirgamaya, Mrityurmar Amritam Gamaya. Oh, great, profound truth, lead us from evil to the good. Lead us from darkness to light, from death to immortality. So this aspiration must find a practical way of being practiced by an Indian, whoever believes in it. So the ancient, what we called Hindu, you know, Hinduism is a word which came with the much later. It was sometimes called Sanatana Dharma, the eternal quest. Or there was no other particular meaning to cover all the ways of human search in India. But this being the basis of human quest, some found through karma one's activities, work, dedicated to the divine, you see, the yoga word came there. Yoga means essentially not all that you read in propagated by hundreds of gurus today. Yoga has a very simple meaning, union. Union with whom? From whom we have been separated. Hinduism, the so-called Hinduism, believed originally that there is a mighty great truth from which we have come out. Why? That's a different question. But we have come out, and as we have distanced ourselves from that origin, we have assumed the opposite qualities of that origin. That origin is truth, we have become falsehood. The origin is delight, we have become suffering. The origin is immortality, we have become death. Now, from this farthest point, a return journey is yoga, union, a call for union. That's the real meaning of yoga. Now, in this process, because multiplicity was the characteristic of creation, you cannot claim that there is only one way. That power which became manifested as many, that one which became many, out of joy he became many. So many must be the ways to go back to the one. So those who believed that since the whole universe is divine in action, if I align myself with the divine section, how do I do it? Whatever I do, I offer it to the divine. I believe that this is also, I'm ordained to perform this. That one who does that, he's performing karma yoga. One who is a karma yogi. Karma yogi is not somebody who acts a lot, but one in his consciousness who tries to align himself through his work with the very source from which he had come. Some people believed that I must have more and more wisdom, knowledge about the Supreme Creator. They study, they meditate, they try to find out what the meaning of truth. They are searching for jnana or wisdom, prudence, knowledge. They are called jnana yogi. There are others who believe that love is the real force of union. As in human life, we see how many, it is in a distorted way, of course, we still see love brings together two persons, though in a very imperfect way. So the same love must be the secret of my union with the Supreme from which I have come away. So they are prema yogi or bhakti yogis. You see, sometimes in Hindu mythology, we have illustrations of these truths. Krishna is a very popular deity. Now, you identify yourself with the cowherd boys. You know the story of Krishna. The cowherd boys of Gopu and Vrindavan. He is your friend. You approach the divine as your friend. You identify yourself with the women folk, gopis of Gopu and Vrindavan. He becomes your lover. You identify yourself with his comrades like Arjuna. He becomes your friend, philosopher, guide. So the divine can be approached in many ways. That is the essential truth of what we call today Hinduism, not the bizarre way in which it is being promoted today.
Yes, I agree. You know, my question, I think I should ask you the question once again, the way Maharishi Aurobindo, when he was a very active revolutionary, and he left all the political fields and went to Pondicherry and became a sannyasi, and you live there now in his ashram. But my question again, when you said about the karma yogi and all, the way we can term Gandhi as a karma yogi, now the present context again, I am asking you the same question. The distortions in the political context on Hinduism, what is happening in India, if we fail to address that, if as you propagate the idea of Hinduism in the you know the right or honest spirit, I appreciate it. But the distortions which is happening at our land now, the way it is used for the political gains and all, what do you think as a writer? I do not know whether I have the liberty to ask you, considering your age, your experience, and your plane of thinking is on a higher level. But people representing the younger generation, we people are really worried about the distortions which is happening. Whether these distortions will kill the very idea of Indianness which you propagate?
Well, certainly there are possibilities. We have seen so many great civilizations going, being disrupted by hostile forces. Well, it all depends on the people of India. I believe an average human being is armed with sufficient common sense. As your question itself implies that you are aware of the distortions and unfortunate interpretations of a great idealism which is being propagated by some people. Let me aspire that like you, there will be hundreds and thousands more who can also feel that. So if as a nation we decide to suspend our common sense and conscience and are led by demagogy, whatever it is, by in the name of Hinduism or name of any other religion or in the name of any political ideology also, as a nation, we are doomed. Well, that may happen also. The choice is ours, the people's choice. I cannot prophesy. I cannot predict what will happen tomorrow. But your suspicion, your doubts are genuine. But at the same time, my faith is there that after probably a period of suffering, a period of being misled, people will be disillusioned about the demagogues, and they will again return to the core of the truth and try to rediscover in themselves what it is. Not a question of Hinduism or anything. What is the aim of life? You ask any man, have you ever thought about your aim of life? I'm sure if they're honest, 90% will stammer, they will stagger. No, they have never thought about it. If they think, they will say, my aim is to get happiness in life. Nothing wrong in that. But through the struggles, one realizes gradually that happiness cannot be obtained simply by external means. I remember my student days, early days, once I was the guest of a very wealthy man in Mumbai in those days. Air conditioning had just come to India. And he had an air conditioned room. Also, he allotted me only one night. I was his guest. Also, air conditioned room. And throughout the night, I can hear, I could not sleep because he's almost groaning with something wrong with him. And his bedroom was in those days a tourist attraction. He had spent few lakhs in preparing a wonderful bedroom. I come to the veranda, I come to the terrace, look down, it is summer, and on the pavement, a rickshaw puller's family is lying, hand pulled rickshaw in those days. From time to time, they are laughing aloud. They do not know whether they will have a breakfast in the morning or not. They are laughing. This man, in a millionaire, you see, bedroom, and with $1 million in the bank, probably $1 billion, he cannot have a sleep. So you can have a wonderful bed, you may not have an hour of sleep. So happiness does not depend on the external amenity to enjoy or the circumstances even. There is something that in ourself. Well, maybe through a lot of suffering, we'll come back to that realization. Situation will gradually change. Thank you. I have nothing else to say about it.
Now we have...
I'm as helpless as you are.
another 25 minutes, and now I'm getting into the book, My Little India. It's an amazingly well-written book. I have no other words to say. And I have a few questions based on this book. This book is available in the National Book Trust Pavilion here. The first article itself on Andaman cellular jail. You were saying about the Indian psyche, and you say that, you know, searching for happiness and all. My question is, how the Indian psyche worked within the minds of the inmates of the cellular jail?
Well, very good question. A common sense oriented question, practical. Some of you might have seen that terrible cellular jail in Andamans. Imagine the prisoners there, those who do not know if ever they will come out of it. What were their psychological condition, concept of happiness, etc. They were all great idealists. You see, one characteristic of man is every human being has an ideal, whether he knows it or he does not know it. Now, that reminds me, in Gujarat, there was a great social reformer called Ravi Shankar Maharaj. Now, no, I won't go into details. I'll go to a very brief instance I'll give. You see, in 18th century, in several states of India, there were some gangs of criminals known as thugs, T-H-U-G-S, thugs. Thuggery is a word in English dictionary you will find. These thugs were criminals, murderers. Their weapon was a yard of linen. In those days, there were no tourism. People traveled either for business or for pilgrimage. So the thugs will accompany some travelers. And at a given moment, they will put around the traveler's neck that linen and give such a twist that he will die. And whatever he's carrying, they will take away. There was one English police officer called Sleeman. So he took it upon himself to completely suppress this thuggery. And he succeeded practically. Even today, there's a village in Bengal called Slimanpur in his honor. Anyway, so there is a writer, Meadows Taylor, an Anglo-Indian, not Anglo-Indian in present sense of the time. He is an Englishman, but writing on Indian subjects. So the one moonlit night, in front of Sliman's bungalow, a gang of thugs who have been captured are made to sit. And Meadows Taylor is asking the leader of the gang, suppose you are accompanying a traveler, but after some time you come to know the fellow does not have even a rupee with him. You will not kill him, no? The thug leader looks at him wistfully and says, Sahib, what do you think of us? Simply because we don't have to make any profit, we will not do our duty. Gain or no gain, since Providence has put him in our company, we have to kill him. This thug also has an ideology. That is his ideal. Now, Ravi Shankar Maharaj was trying to reform a tribe who were thieves. So one day a young man says that, sir, what can I do when I was passing at night through the village street, Goddess Lakshmi, goddess of wealth, buried underneath. He calls me, come, Bhola, liberate me. Because misers don't deserve me. You see, this is just ideal. Now, the thing is, those who are living in cellular jails, they are conscious idealists. For them, motherland was the divine mother. And before the task of liberating that mother from the clutches of a demon who is either sucking the blood out of mother's breast, nothing is important. No suffering is there which is not worth presenting at the altar of the mother's liberation. So this idealism sustained them. And I have, in my early life in Pondicherry, there are still three great revolutionaries of the first decade of the 20th century. Liberated, set free from, those who survived the cellular jail, I used to talk to them. What sparks of idealism and love for the motherland they had. Even when the freedom fighters' pensions were given, they refused to take. We were not fighting for pension. We are fighting as our offering to the mother. That's all. Thank you. Thank you.
Look, now we were discussing about the great patriotic males who were in cellular jail. Now I am coming to the women of India, based on an article in the same book. You wrote about three women in Rajasthan, Rani Padmini, Panyadhai, and Princess Krishna Kumari. And we know that, you know, recently a Hindi film on Rani Padmini and Alauddin Khilji became a hit. And there were debates, and there were even violent reactions to the film. But my question is, how do you see women in northern Indian history? How bad were our men to their women?
I believe men were bad to women, not only in northern India, but all over the world. If you look into the histories of the civilized countries, in how many countries voting even was denied, right of voting was denied to them, even after India. India became an adult franchise country. So definitely, and particularly during, we have to remember that modern ideas are really too modern. Till 1800 something, slavery was there, slave market was there. You could purchase a human being. You could feel, try him, press his muscles whether like you try a material object, whether it will be serviceable or not. So that way, it prevailed everywhere. In certain civilizations, ancient civilizations, it took the form of an religious ideology. In certain other places, simply it was a tradition. So India, it often took the form of a religious ideology also. That was the difference. But I think, except for degrees, the difference was not much between the treatment of women in northern India or treatment of women elsewhere. Moods were different. Situations were different, that's all. But things are definitely changing.
You are optimistic about it. You are optimistic about it.
Absolutely optimistic, because there is the trend of the time, the law of the time, ultimately. You see, the entire 20th, in the history of humanity, no century was as eventful as 20th century. And all the developments tend towards only one thing. Imperialism collapsed, colonialism collapsed. What is still more important, imperialism, colonialism were only a few hundred years old, but monarchy, since the beginning of civilization, there was monarchy all over India, all over the world. Monarchy also gradually disappeared, barring in a few places, also limited monarchy. And feudalism collapsed also. All these revolutionary changes tend toward ever greater freedom of the individual. And this individual is not simply male, but also female. So in course of time, the whole tendency, this is an evolutionary tendency, bringing the self-dignity entirely to a human individual. And despite all the obstacles and clashes of the past traditions, trying to, check the progress. The progress is inevitable, and it will be, equality will be established between men and women, no doubt.
Thank you. For the last four decades, if I'm right, more than four decades, you are there in Puducherry.
I am?
Puducherry in Aramido Ashram.
Right.
And I read a beautiful article on River Kaveri in this book.
Yes.
My question, do you think that these Dravidian traditions, have a disconnect with the Indianness that we often talk about? I heard whatever you said about Tiruvalluvar, Chilappathikaram and all, after listening to all your talks on Chilappathikaram, and after reading these articles, I have a doubt that whether these Dravidian traditions have a disconnect with the Indianness that we propagate.
I believe this is an impression which has been promoted by political interests in during the last 60-70 years. Once upon a time, as great historian and anthropologist established, Sanskrit was the language of all southern royal courts. Kerala, you know, what a great country promoting Sanskrit. Even dance forms are made of Sanskrit and everything. Now, even the language Tamil, one of the oldest languages in the world. In India, we are proud of two languages, Sanskrit and Tamil, among the oldest languages in the world. And modern research tends to suggest that both Sanskrit and Tamil had one origin, one common origin, which is lost, but it can be rediscovered if our anthropologists and linguistic historians were really serious. So, despite all the external diversity, the psychic oneness of Dravidian and so-called non-Dravidian India, there is no difference in that. I have been living for 56 years in South. Before that, I was born and brought up in another part of India. I have seen the same vibrations of sympathy, empathy, same vibrations of attitude, belief, celebrations of festivities, the spirit behind them, fundamentally absolutely the same. So it was last 70, 80 years, or rather 60 years, when things were artificially created, situations, slogans, evidences, which brought about this impression of divisiveness. I believe we will overcome this. Both South and North will override this kind of misconceptions.
No, I totally appreciate your point. At the same time, you know, for example, you said about the dance forms and all. Recently, I was reading Professor David Shulman's book, Tamil Biography. It's a biography of the language Tamil, written by the renowned scholar David Shulman. Now, now take the example of Bharatanatyam. You say that, you know, the Tamil as a language has strong connects with the Sanskrit and all. But we know that, you know, in modern history, how the dance forms of Tanjavu were appropriated by the Brahmins later period. That also happened in the last 60, 70 years. And how the Bharatanatyam lost its Dravidian roots and got into the so-called Indianness and called Bharatanatyam. Therefore, you know, I totally appreciate, but there is another point of view on the Dravidian and thing. Now, I do not know whether we have time for listeners' question. And one more question I wanted to say is, there is a beautiful piece on Ujjain.
Beautiful?
Article on the city of Ujjain.
Yes, yes.
Ujjain had philosophy for India. Ujjain had great poets like Kalidasa for India. And Vikramaditya ruled from Ujjain. Ujjain probably, other than Varanasi, Ujjain is a place which had that long history and all. How do you think Ujjain in literature, especially your appreciation for Kalidasa? This is my last question based on the book.
Right.
And then we will go back to your journey to Puducherry.
What is the question?
Your appreciation for Kalidasa from Ujjain.
Which you see, certainly, I mean, sometimes I wonder, what was the kind of social culture when a person like, a phenomenon like Kalidasa had been possible? Now, you know the fantastic folk legend about Kalidasa. Kalidasa was supposed to be a fool. And some scholars who were insulted by a certain princess, they managed through some intrigues to marry the princess to this fool, which was Kalidasa. Now, very soon the princess found out that her husband is a fool. She has been deceived. And so she drove him out of the palace. Kalidasa came to the temple of Mother Goddess and snatched the sword from her hand, Mother Goddess's hand, and decided to kill himself. And the Mother Goddess said, "Stop. Why do you want to kill yourself?" "Well, you make me a scholar, poet, or I kill myself." The mother says, "My child, in 14 coming lifetimes, you are not supposed to become a scholar. It will take you evolution of 14 lifetimes for you to become a scholar poet." Then she said, "No, then I kill myself." To cut short the story, there is a compromise. On this spot, Kalidasa was made to die 14 times and come back to life 14 times. Summarizing the whole 14 lifetimes of evolution, he emerged out of the temple, the great poet Kalidasa. What does the legend, folk legends have also meaning? What is the significance? The significance is very simple. Such was the genius of this man. The contemporary people could not believe that it could be possible without the grace of the divine and without 14 lifetimes of development and progress and studies. So it takes the fantastic shape of a folk tale. So that is Kalidasa of Ujjaini. Now, it is a very significant question. My thing is, I am yet to understand the Indian society of a time when poets like Kalidasa were possible. I do not know, according to the great experts, the maturity of a language can be judged by its capacity to express much through the few. In that, Sanskrit is unquestionably unrivaled. It is a language which can express a lot through precise phrases and words. To support the evolution of such a language, which could come to a state when Kalidasa wrote his Meghadutam or Abhijnana Shakuntalam, there must have been a great civilization supporting it. Where is that civilization's evidence? I am yet to come across a civilization which could have supported a language to come to this maturity where Sanskrit of Kalidasa was possible. So I just remain wonderstruck. And Ujjaini of Varanasi, it is said, Mark Twain says, Varanasi is older than time. Now I can say Ujjaini is also older than history, because we do not know the backdrop of the emergence of a genius like Kalidasa. Thank you very much.
Any questions from the audience for him? We have 5 more minutes. Can you introduce yourself first?
My name is Shah Jahan, I'm a writer. Thank you very much for your wonderful talk and I just wanted to ask you 2 questions, sir, briefly. One, how do you compare and contrast Hinduism and Hindutva? My second question is, how do you see the future of bilingual writing in Indian literature? Because you are one of the foremost representatives of bilingual literary writing in India. Thank you.
Yes. The 2 questions are, one is very theoretical, one is very practical. Well, the first question was, Hinduism and Hindutva. Those who use the word Hindutva and Hinduism in English, are they conscious of the difference? They use it to mean simply what we call Hindutva in Sanskrit or Tamil or any other language in India. They just translate it. Now, today we are differentiating between the sense that Hindutva is what I have explained, a tradition of quest and aspiration. Quest for the meaning of life, aspiration to realize that goal, that is real Hindutva. Now, Hinduism, as loosely used, is constituted of certain very, very superficial slogans, superficial motivated phrases and supporting certain rituals, certain traditions, which are often detrimental to the spirit of human growth. So it is necessary for us to realize that better we don't use these words. We use simply the goal of life. What is the human goal? Human goal, as I explained elaborately, yoga means the union with the very source from which we have come. Whether you call yourself a Hindu, X, Y, or Z, as long as you're trying to unite yourself with that source, as Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, I repeat again, Sadoma Sadgamayo, Tamoshoma Jyotirgamayo, Mrityurmar Amritam Gamayo, lead us from ignorance to, lead us from evil to good, from darkness to light, from death to immortality. As long as these aspirations are guiding our life, our activities, our inner quest, whether I am a Hindu or non-Hindu or anything, I am following the Vedic tradition of Sanatana Dharma. Whatever name Hinduism came much later, so we did not very much give importance to that particular word. It is this Indian quest, you can say. And this quest has not changed over the thousands of years. If we analyze ourselves, what I am seeking, my answer will be superficially, I am seeking happiness and satisfaction in life. If I go further down my consciousness and try to explore what are the means of that, I will very soon discover nothing external can fulfill these conditions. It is something inner wealth I have to achieve, I have to realize, which alone can satisfy this quest. So that is the basic, perception of inheritance, I should say. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Next question was, yes, of course. You see, you'll be surprised if you read my friend, Mr. Gopalakrishnan, referred to my book, Chasing the Rainbow, Growing Up in Indian Village, published by Oxford University Press. It is paperback edition is available now. Ordinarily, it was hardback, it's not available. Now, I have referred to there. I was born in a remote village. No opportunity of English education, English medium school or anything. I used to write spontaneously in my mother tongue. I was happy with it. When I was in the college, one day, somebody read out an article to me written by, ironically, an Indian living abroad, giving a picture, so-called picture of urban life, Indian rural life in most despicable terms. I was shocked. Born and brought up in a remote Indian village, I know the vibration of nobility which prevails in the atmosphere. I know the people's truthfulness, their love and affection. Today many things have been distorted thanks to politics, but then it was different India. So I decided to write in English to uphold the characters and the atmosphere of East India. And I have been doing that. I believe bilingualism, because in very practically speaking, we do not have a trained, very, very, very specialized class of translators. When I read a Russian Dostoevsky's novel in English, I don't feel that it is something un-English unless I came across the name, the characters' names. Everything is so natural. Similarly, we can't say that a novel translated from Malayalam, some have been successfully translated also, to my mother tongue also, now can have the same grip on me like a spontaneously written novel by a writer in his own mother tongue. So because we don't have, and then, when I translate your work into English, I must be entirely faithful to your text. That sometimes creates a great handicap. There are phrases and words which cannot be literally translated. But suppose I am the writer who writes in Odia, and I am the writer who is also writing in English. I have the liberty to change the orientation of a certain sentence to recreate the exact vibration, the exact point or exact feeling which was there in the original mother tongue. So bilingualism is a blessing in the sense that one's own translations can become more lively because he's not handicapped by the moral obligation to be literally factual, true to the original work. Thank you very much. I wish there are more bilingual writers in coming years in India.
I think the time is getting over. Any more questions for you? One more question.
Thank you. Thank you for being here, sir. I'm a writer. My name is Jonathan. I just have a small question. India is such a big country, and the book title is My Little India. What made you choose that?
Very beautiful question. Now, My Little India means the little of India I know. India is too vast for anyone to say My India. So India, the little of India I know, that has inspired me to give the title My Little India. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir, for sharing your experience. And
I'm thankful to my interviewer, Sesh Gopalakrishnanji. All questions were well thought out. And to the audience, the three questions I got, they are all so cogent and so helpful.
Yes, personally, they are
and
happy.
National Book Trust, my dear editor is there. My direct my two editors are there, my senior editor, Dr. Kumar Vikramji, I'm most thankful to you for organizing these things.
I'm personally happy to see, because of a person who was moving with the great stalwarts of great writers of my mother tongue, like he was mentioning about Thagadi Sivasankarappula, he was mentioning about Ayyappa Panikkar, he knows our great writer M.T. Vasudevan Nair, and a person who moved with great writers of our land. And it was a great opportunity for me personally to share this audio stage with you. Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks a lot. Thank you all.